Okay, well, I want to thank everybody for coming out. It's starting to feel a little more like ice fishing season, so that's a good thing. Actually, a little colder here than it was down at home, so hopefully they can lock up here before too long, and we can get out on it. So one of my favorite things to chase in the midwinter period are crappies. Typically, the midwinter period is kind of tough. The fish kind of get their winter doldrums, things slow down. The reason I like crappies is because they're pretty predictable. They go into a midwinter pattern that on almost any lake you can go and you can fish in the same pattern, and you're going to find them. So I'm going to tell you a little bit today about what that pattern is, how to fish it, and some of the things that what makes a crappie tick during that midwinter period. So anyway, if you got any questions, just throw your hand up. It was kind of driving the presentation quite a bit tonight, so feel free to ask questions. So crappies get a big disservice because they're lumped together in this group called panfish, right? When people say panfish, they think crappies, bluegills, and perch. And it's kind of a disservice because bluegills and crappies are kind of different, especially when you get to talking about these slab crappies. Slab crappies are a little bit more of a predator than a bluegill is. For instance, bluegills, their food source is mainly bugs. They're small mouths, means they can only eat small things, right? So they're limited to eating things like bloodworms, mayfly nymphs, caddis nymphs, those types of things that are in the water column. They feed anywhere in the water column, meaning they'll come up to food or they'll go down to food, but the majority of their time is spent feeding in the downward position. So they're looking down for food quite a bit. A lot of that's because the bugs they eat sometimes either live on or come up from the bottom. Most of those insects are burrowing insects. They live in that muck that's at the bottom of the lake. So when they come up out of that muck, that's when the bluegills are looking down and waiting to intercept them. Crappies, on the other hand, they do eat bugs. A lot of times you'll catch crappies right where you catch the bluegills, in the weeds especially. But because the crappies have a larger mouth, it means they can eat larger things, right? In fact, larger crappies prefer bait fish over bugs. They'll eat both, but if they can get a bait fish, there's a lot more calories per chunk, right? They have to burn calories in order to consume calories, and they expend a lot fewer calories in relation to the number of calories in a bait fish than in a bug. So it's a much more efficient food for them to eat, and there's a lot more bang for the buck. So they get either bloodworms, they eat the nymphs, zooplankton. They're more active and more available during the hard water. The bait fish aren't nearly as active because they're in the kind of the same slope that a lot of the predator fish are in. Crappies do upfeed quite a bit more than bluegills do, so they're always looking up for food. They will go down, we've caught them right on the bottom before, but a large majority of the time they're looking up for their food. Where can you find both of these? Well, bluegills are almost always in the weeds, especially early ice when the weeds are still green. That's where you're going to find them. In fact, when we go to a new lake or a lake, even a lake we know, the first thing we look for is weeds if we're looking for bluegills. And in lakes like Okoboji, where weeds is the abundant type of cover, the crappies will be in those weeds right there along with them almost all year long. Crappies, on the other hand, like I said, they can sometimes be found in the weeds along with the bluegills. But that's not really their preferred habitat. They like woody cover. And in this midwinter period, they'll actually suspend over the basin over nothing. They're just out there hanging off the bottom in nothingness. School of crappies can sometimes be a lot bigger than a school of bluegills. Bluegills are twos, threes, and fours. Sometimes you'll find the crappies that way too. But sometimes you can find the crappies in huge schools. And that's one of the great things I love about catching this time period of the year. Because it can look like this sometimes. Wait for it.
Wrong slide.
Yeah, here they come. So you can see there's all kinds of weeds down there, but they're not actually in the weeds. They're traveling over the top of them.
Where's this spot at? I want to go there.
What lake was this?
This was a little clear.
No, not really. I wouldn't tell them your secret spot.
So sometimes when you find them suspended out over the basin in midwinter, this is what they look like. Now, the fact that they're suspended makes it really easy to find in electronics. Because you can drop it down the hole and you can see them 6 feet off the bottom. Sometimes it's 60 feet of water, they'll be 20 feet off the bottom, just hanging right there in the middle of the water column. Those are really easy to pick up on the flasher. Especially when they're in a school like this. Now this is kind of analogous to a perch, because perch also like to be out in those big mud flats out in the middle of the basin. But typically those perch are hugging the bottom, which makes them a little harder to find with the electronics. You got to really watch that bottom signal and see if there's flickering in it, or see if you can get it to pop off the bottom before you can know for sure that they're there. That's why the crappie thing is really nice this time of year, because there's a fence that really easy to see. It's kind of the kind of dog that runs the pack. Everybody bows down to him. He's the leader, right? We're in fact the world, the same thing. So I believe almost all fish species have this same type of thing. You ever better notice when you first pop that new hole, usually the first fish or two you pull up are the biggest fish, right? After that, the fish keep getting smaller and smaller and smaller. That's because those bigger fish are bigger for a reason. Because they eat the food. That's their job. They've got to be the first ones to food, the first ones to eat it. They got to outrace all those smaller doves, all those smaller fish, to get to the food to eat it. They're going to eat larger food sources than the smaller fish, because the smaller fish usually just pick up the crumbs, right? And that's part of the reason I think the crappies look up, because they're always waiting to raise up whatever's falling down to them. So those bigger fish, they're going to be riding at the top of the school, right? Does that make sense? Because they want to be the first ones that food that's coming from above them. This is also a reason I think that plastics are so effective. One of the things I really like about plastics is that you won't necessarily catch more fish when you switch to plastics, but your quality of fish you catch are going to improve. And part of that's because you're not catching the smaller fish, you're just catching the bigger ones. And again, if you go back to the saltfish hypothesis, that would explain it. Because these bigger fish, they don't care what it looks like, or smells like, or tastes like. They just know it's food falling from above, and they gotta eat it to feel good. So they just come up and they hit it. Right? Or even if they don't hit it right away, they see these little guys coming, and I gotta eat it, I got no choice. Bam. Little guys, they're like, I better make sure this is food first. I don't get a lot of this stuff, so I'm not really sure what it is. So they'll go up and they'll mouth it, they'll taste it. And if it doesn't taste like food, if it's plastic, they're probably going to spit it out and just ignore it. These bigger fish don't care. This is their job. They got to eat it before anything else eats it, so they're just going to come up and they're just going to eat it. So that's one of the reasons I think plastic works so well, especially with crappies. And it also explains where the crappies, why the bigger crappies are out on the top of the school always. So when you see a school of crappies suspended out of the middle of the lake on your flasher, where are you gonna drop your jig to? You gotta bring them down to the top of that school. You wanna drop down to the middle, you're gonna go right past those big boys and down to the little ones. You wanna pull those big guys off the top. And after you pull two or three bigger ones off, you see the size start going down. It's because most of the big ones have been caught now. So you can do one or two things. You can sit there and continue to catch smaller and smaller and smaller fish, or you can move to a new hole and pick off the three or four bigger fish in that pod. You can do that for the rest of the day. That's why I'm not a big proponent of camping out at one spot for too long. But I can be highly mobile and move from hole to hole. When you're trying to find these base crappies, sometimes you got to drill two or three football fields worth of holes and move from hole to hole. And when we're really running the gun in, when we're fishing a tournament, or the day's watering down, we want to get on some fish before the day's done, we'll just drop our transducer down on the hole to hole to hole and check it for those suspended marks. If we don't see them, we don't stop them. We just keep going. And eventually you're going to land on a hole where you can see that it's going to light up. There's fish 10 feet off the bottom. That's when we stop the fish. And one exception is, we know there's fish in the area, we're just not finding them. I use the side finder on my Vexilar. How many of you found that side finder button on your Vexilar yet? No? Nobody's using the Vexilar side finder?
No.
Oh. Alright, so it's not really a button per se. It's more of a technique. So we all know how the transducer has a cone angle, right? It shoots down. Well, that's designed so it shoots straight down. So what we do is we actually swing our transducer in the hole, which causes that transducer to kick out just enough, but we're actually seeing out to the sides. And it's really cool the first time you do it because you'll be swinging it. And every time you come to this point, you can see a flicker on your screen at 10 feet or 30 feet, or 5 feet under the ice. And so that's telling you there's a crappie just outside your cone angle right here. So I'd move over 6 or 8 feet, drill a hole so you can get right on top of it. We use that, especially in tournaments, when we're down in the 11th hour, we're trying to upgrade our fish, or we need 2 more crappies to get our limit. We gotta find these fish. They're scattered, they're ones and twos. So we're not gonna stand and fish in any one hole. So we'll just side finder every hole and find those marks. A lot of people just walk by because they didn't see it directly below. Drop down, pick them up, bam. So you notice I've also talked a lot about crappie suspending, right? This is a really key part of this whole pattern. Why is that important? Because these fish are out here suspended, like I said, near suspended animation, above the bottom of the lake. Food's scarce, it's midwinter. So they're just there trying to expend as little energy as they can. They're being opportunistic. So they're not chasing fish, but if you know something swims by, they're gonna grab it. What that means is if you can find these suspended fish and get a bait in front of them, it's almost 100% you're gonna catch them. Because that's what they're there for. They're there waiting for something to fall right on their nose. They're not gonna go a long way to get food, but the fact that they're out there suspended makes it easier for you to find them. And once you do, if you put that bait right in front of them, you're gonna catch them. So, you know, like I said, we do catch crappies off the bottom from time to time, but we can find them suspended like that. That means they're in a feeding mood. Those are the fish we want to target. Saw that at Wind Creek several years ago. Out on the main channel there, you find fish in the bottom, couldn't give them the bites, you find the suspended crappies, drop down, bam, fish on them. And that was another example. We fished the tournament out there 5 or 6 years ago. It was winding down the 11th hour. We had like 3 crappies left to get our bag. And we just hopped from hole to hole to hole. And every 10th or 11th hole, we pick up a crappie. So we picked up those last few fish right before weigh-in. And we went to the weigh-in. We got 30 that day. So keep those things in mind. Those are all important things when you're chasing the basin back to crappies. So what is a basin? Basin is really the bulk of the water volume of the lake. It's the biggest, most bowl-shaped area that you can find. And most lakes that we fish around here are reservoirs. So usually it's somewhere over the main river channel where it kind of flattens out. You can see on this map of Big Creek here, I circled that in red. See how there's not a lot of feature there. It's kind of flat, opens out, it's off the main channel, so you know it's about the deepest part of the lake. And some lakes may have 2 or 3 different basins, especially some of these glacial potholes or these natural lakes. Again, those crappies will be suspended there. They're feeding crappies, so if you can get on top of them, put a jig in front of their nose, they're gonna eat. So this was the national championship we fished about 10 years ago. You can see this lake might have several basins. This could be a big basin here. This could be a big basin area. Another basin over here, this could be one. So our job is to dissect those and try to figure out where those, which basin those crappies are gonna be using. They may be using multiples. So when we first looked at this map, my first instinct was, they're going to be here. We went out there and drilled hole after hole, and we couldn't find any. It wasn't until we started fishing this basin that we started picking up a few fish. So we started targeting these little holes within that basin, and the crappies just stacked up over that little 30-foot hole. It was about as big as a basketball court, baby, and you couldn't believe the crappies were stacked up. It was like that video I showed you at the beginning. So a lot of times it's looking for those anomalies in that basin area. Is there a pile of rocks they might be suspended over? It's an area of where the bottom composition is better for those burrowing insects. You find those, they might be crappies stacked up over those too. And you can tell that by looking at the signal on your vexillary. You can tell what the bottom looks like there, what the composition is. Another example, crappies can move too, quickly. When they're suspended midwinter like that, they're always kind of in a transition. What they're really waiting for is the spring to start to come, the water to start to warm up, and they're going to start transitioning back to the shallow areas where they're going to spawn in a month or two. So even though they're out there in suspended animation, they're always kind of on the drift, kind of like a band of gypsies. You just never know where they're going to end up. When we pre-fished for the tournament, they were just off that sharp break line, kind of where you might expect them to be. This is one of those sticky bottom areas that's at the bottom of a basin. So, ground, the bottom there is perfect for burrowing insects. Sunday morning we launched for the tournament, there wasn't a fish to be found there. So it was our job to figure out where they went. Well, they went to more of a basin area. This right here. So don't be afraid to fish. Just because it's a basin area doesn't guarantee there's going to be crappies there. But if there are basin areas in a lake, your chances are pretty good that one of those is going to be crappies. So don't be afraid to check an area quickly and then lift another one. You know, use that running gun technique that I described. Don't stop to fish until you actually see marks. Because you can get hung up on a hole all day and not actually figure out where the crappies are. Okay, so that's pretty much it. Like I said, it's a really predictable pattern. Almost every lake you fish is going to have some basin area. And if you get up there when the fishing kind of slows down in the middle of the winter, that's where you're going to find them. And typically they'll be there until they get ready to move in to the spawn in the spring. So look for those basin areas, learn how to read your lake maps, and find those on the lake map. And just, you know, check those off by one by one when you get to the lake, because eventually one of those basin areas is going to hold the crappies you're looking for. Okay, any questions? A lot of information I threw at you. Woo! Yeah?
Did you know that there's a new product? It's a plastic clip that you can put on your transducer that bends it sideways?
Yeah. And there have been things like that. I think AquaView actually had an arm and you can do something like that with that one time. That's a great way. I mean, I can't overemphasize how valuable that side finder is. Now, those properties can be dispersed over such a broad area.
You know, when you're tournament fishing, you might not have time to put it on, take it off.
But you might run one with that and then have one. And that's the kind of things we do for tournament fishing. Absolutely.
So you got to take the transducer, put it on the hole, and slow it around
like this? Yeah, just
Or valve big mount.
No, we actually much prefer to do it in a circle because you'll see it'll be a pattern. Every once, like when you get to this point right here, you'll see a flash on your flash. So then you can look where in the circle when you see that flash, it's going to tell you it's right here. So somewhere over here is where that crappie's hanging out.
Do you remember I was saying this when we chased those crappie all over that lake?
Yep. Yep.
That's kind of how
and that's happens. That's your classic basin crappie bite. That's why I say it's a great pattern. Almost any lake you go to, you're going to be able to find it and work it. And it may take some chasing, because sometimes they're moving faster than others. But that second day of the championship where I showed that they moved on us, that's a perfect example. They'll do that, especially when they start getting pressure. They had so many people pre-fishing them that Saturday before, but they moved. And they moved not very far, but they went to a basin area right where you might expect them to go. It's just a matter of which basin area they moved to, and that's where they were at. Good stuff. Anything else?
That Big Creek example, you're talking about mid-winter there, right? So early winter, that doesn't really help?
Yeah, Big Creek's a little different. So any of the artificial lakes that have a channel, that's always going to hold fish. I mean, any lake that has an old creek channel run through it, a river channel, fish that channel. Especially places where there's a break down the channel that comes up onto a flat. They can move back and forth in a very, very short amount of time. Big Creek's had a lot of brush pots, and so that kind of skews things a little bit. Sometimes Big Creek, the most important thing is figuring out which depth the brush pile they're at that they're using. Sometimes they'll be stacked up in the deeper brush piles, sometimes they'll be up the shallower brush piles. So sometimes you got to figure that out too. It's a little different than, there's a lot of structure in Big Creek, and some of the other lakes don't have quite as much. Brushy Creek's another good example. With all the timber in Brushy Creek, you're really hard to find the crappies sometimes. So we usually target the timber that's right off the creek channel. Almost always you'll find the crappies up somewhere off the creek channel in the brush, off the trees off the side of the creek channel. Question? Anything else?
He keeps throwing it.
Oh. Okay, well, thanks for listening, guys. Appreciate it. You guys have any questions or about my stuff?